on today's Faces and Places. Insect venom is a key part of scientific research, and the bee man, Kim Vandergriff, shows us how he collects it. Ooh la la, Sophie tries her hand at French cuisine at Bercani French Cafe. But first, the Enzian Theater serves up dinner as well as hard-to-find movies.
Enzian is a full-time independent cinema located in Maitland, Florida. We opened in 1985 with a screening of Broken Blossoms and with Lillian Gish, the silent film star, attending. It was a very exciting night. We've been here showing independent and foreign film to this community since then and have just had a wonderful time doing it. The word Enzian is actually the name of a flower. It's an alpine flower, and it's a little metaphorical. An Enzian is a thing of great beauty, grows high in the Alps. It's difficult to find, takes a lot of work. And there we are. I like to think that Enzian is almost the anti-megaplex, if you will. At Enzian, every individual that walks in the doors is really important to us. We are in the business of community service and building community. Our mission statement actually is to entertain, educate, inspire, and connect the community through film. And the interesting thing about that mission statement is that film is actually the last word. And so we are in the business of community building, and we're using movies as our tool to do it. We have this unique full-service restaurant built right into the cinema experience, so it's dinner and a movie all at once.
Yeah, I think movies and food go together pretty well. Would say most of our customers would agree. There are some purists out there who would much rather we just had a traditional theater, but I think it's great. You're kind of stimulating all the senses at the same time. So, and you can combine the whole dinner and a movie experience into one experience. Well, over the years, I've been here for 4 years, we've definitely tried to make it a little nicer. I mean, when I got here, it was really more tater tots and quesadillas and bar food, which is perfectly fine, but we're just trying to elevate the level of what we do a little bit. So it's been a really gradual thing, so we're always trying to look to take it to the next step when we create the menu. Also keeping in mind things that will be easy to eat in the dark, and as well as easy for us to prepare quickly, because we are feeding so many people in such a short period of time. So occasionally we'll try to do some specials based on the movie that's showing. It's obviously pretty easy if we have like an Italian film or a French film. So we try to do some specials in that regard. Other times we might have something that has some really gory content or is a little disturbing in one way or the other, and that becomes kind of a challenge because people might lose their appetite a little bit. So we try to step back on the specials in those instances and kind of let people eat popcorn and pizza and things like that. We do have popcorn, but that's more or less where it ends. We have nachos on our menu, but they don't come in a plastic cup with fluorescent orange artificial cheese. We fry the chips, we make the sauce ourselves. Try to do everything from scratch the right way, even if it is something as mundane and typical as nachos. So we do have the popcorn, really good desserts, but no raisinettes or candy or anything like that. Really good beer and wine list, really good tea and coffee drinks. So we really try to do our best to differentiate ourselves, with the exception of popcorn, from the other theaters, because people tend to expect that type of thing when they come here and get frustrated when they, you know, and they don't really understand what it is we're trying to do. So we try to make it as evident as possible. We're trying to give a full-blown restaurant experience, not a concession stand.
A lot of people don't realize that we actually are a nonprofit. It does make it a lot different. We rely a lot on food and beverage sales. Like, that's a huge part of staying open. And since we're not a corporate environment, like, we really rely on people becoming members of our organization to support us. And we rely on people coming and sitting here. And, you know, it's great if they eat the food because that's how we make our money. It's a home-like atmosphere. You can watch a movie sitting on a couch, which you cannot do in a bigger theater. So you can just sit back and relax and watch a film and eat good, gourmet, like, home-cooked food. And we still have popcorn and we still have the soda, so it's not like you're so far out there eating something really fancy. It's just really good food and really good film. And that combination, you cannot beat that. People respond really well. They're really, really supportive of what we do. we have a lot of people coming to us asking, are you going to play this film, are you going to play this film? And we kind of have people contacting us to suggest that we play something. So we get a lot of really good feedback from the community, which and it actually impacts us. Like if we hear someone requesting a film, we might look into it. That might not happen somewhere else. You know, we're not a corporation. So if you make a suggestion to us, we really take it to heart and we'll look into it. And we bring in a wide variety of audiences and we have different festivals that appeal to different groups of the community. So I think we bring in a lot of people and we show them a different side of film.
I'd like to think that our audience is a very, very intelligent audience. You know, I consider myself part of the audience. You know, we have our young demographic, our film students, our college students who are just interested in the art form, in the coolness and hipness of independent film. And then we have our film fans, you know, our retired demographic who supports us greatly. And, you know, those members who have been with us 10 plus years.
There's some hardcore movie people from all different walks of life who we'll see for every single film, but it truly depends. For example, if we're showing a Shakespeare adaptation like we did a while back, The Merchant of Venice with Al Pacino, sold a lot of wine, a lot of cheese plates, a lot of desserts, a lot of things like that. If we show a documentary about the Ramones, on the other hand, we're gonna sell a lot of Pabst and we're gonna sell a lot of nachos and chocolate chip cookies. So it really, it's become kind of predictable based on the movie that's coming, what kind of crowd it's gonna draw. And our programming can be so diverse that it's pretty much a slice of every section of the community.
I love the nonprofit aspect of our organization because it allows us to do some activities which wouldn't normally be done if it was in a for-profit mindset. We do a lot of educational-based initiatives where we're showing films to high school and elementary school students. We do meet the filmmaker activities where we have films from independent filmmakers being shown on the weekends, and the filmmakers in attendance to answer questions to those that are interested in the film topic, those that are interested in the filmmaking process, those that are interested in just that filmmaker. And those are quite enjoyable, and those typically, you know, they're not big money makers, so you don't see them being replicated in other movie theaters. And being that we are a nonprofit and we do survive off memberships and grants to put those programs in place, it allows just us to put a lot more color into our programming throughout the year. We are preparing for events all the time. So, you know, that's my main job, is just preparing for the next event, preparing for next week's event, preparing for next year's film festival. We're in constant preparation mode. And we've been doing this for, you know, 20 plus years. So we have our systems in place and our skills honed, and the team is just, that we're in that culture. So no day is the same. It's quite fun, it's quite enjoyable, it can be quite stressful, but the rewards are immediate, and the people you connect with are just incredible, so it makes it all worth it.
Well, when we have the Florida Film Festival, it's just like a giant party. There are people hanging out constantly. We have filmmakers in town, we have actors and celebrities, and it's 10 days of a nonstop, really, really fun party. It's a lot of hard work, but in the end, it is so worth it.
The festival is usually fun. It's the hardest 10 days of the year, but it's so much fun because there truly is just a festive atmosphere. There's occasionally some celebrities wandering around the property, and just it seems like everybody who's coming here is typically in a better mood during the festival too. So we do our best to have fun with it and enjoy it. We always look forward to it.
It's great because I connect with so many people at so many, from so many different walks of life, so many different age groups, and from so many different geographical locations around the world.
I've made a lot of really good friends that I've stayed in contact with, really interesting like documentarians and other, you know, people who produce feature films, and it's very cool to get to know people who do that sort of thing.
Philip Seymour Hoffman liked my nachos once. That was a pretty good moment. So
another thing we do is popcorn flicks in the park, in Winter Park. Once a month, we show up in the park and we set up a screen. We provide free popcorn. It's a free movie. It's family friendly, of course, with program notes and an introduction by somebody who knows something about this film. And we see in the park, I sometimes wonder why we need a building, because we see hundreds and hundreds, up to over 1,000 people hanging out together, young, old, black, white, huge amount of diversity. and they're gathering together in the park to eat popcorn and watch a movie. The train comes through, and we just stop the movie, and everybody gets up and stretches and hangs out. And I mean, this is community building at its finest. It really is, and it is the heart and soul of what we do here.
We try to keep it pretty fun. I try to make sure everybody takes it seriously, and we're definitely here to serve the best food that we can, not mediocre bar food, like I said. But we tend to have a pretty good time. The atmosphere in this whole place, everybody gets along really well. Everyone has respect for each other. Sometimes it doesn't even seem like a job. We have so much fun. So I just fell in love with the place. It's a great bunch of people, really good organization. I like the fact that we're bringing some culture to this town. And I've never really been cut from the corporate mold, so a lot of the good restaurant jobs are in the big chain restaurants, and it's just not for me. So I just fit here somehow.
Independent film offers something that our patrons can think about once they go home, a movie that sticks with them. People travel, a couple hours to get here. That's pretty fantastic, because I don't think I'd travel, more than 20, 30 minutes to watch a movie. But we offer something that can't be found anywhere else.
I came here and it instantly feels like home. You walk into this theater and you automatically know this is sort of a magical place. You walk through the outside of the building with the trees, and you come in this place that kind of looks like an old home, and you end up in here with all these colorful chairs, and I just instantly connected, and I connected with the people that I work with. Everyone from the office staff to the servers, we're just a big family, and we're all really into this place. We love it.
If your first place and second place, in no particular order, are work and home, where you spend most of your time, some people spend more time at work, some people spend more time at home, but if those are your first two places, then your third place is where you get together to relax, to unwind, to socialize. It is the third place that makes community vital. It's the third place that grows a sense of community and brotherhood and stretching out. But there's a strong theory of third place, and we look at ourselves as one of those places. You'll notice at Enzian, people come early to sit down and hang out here with the rest of the audience before the movie starts. And they stay late out on the patio just to enhance this sense of gathering together.
When people first show up here, they're, the parking's not hard, they're not having to park outside of a mall, they're not having to check anywhere, they just show up at this sort of magical place with an old style marquee, and it's a very different vibe. You just know you're walking into something special.
Hi, I'm Sophie Kay, and we're here at Bercani's Cafe, where the chef owner is going to teach us all about French cuisine, and he is the most wonderful French cook. Julian, this is his name. Julian, how are you today?
Good.
Nice to see you, we're glad Sophie. To be in your French kitchen, and we'd like to know, what are we making today?
We're going to do some veal française, which is veal scallopini, mm-hmm. stretched in flour.
But it's very thin.
Very thin, yeah. It's what we call, we hammered it really lightly without mm-hmm. breaking it. And from there, we season it with a little bit of salt and pepper. And we have an egg mixture.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, we're going to saute it in a pan with olive oil.
Olive oil.
Okay, we're going to start that.
What does your egg mixture consist
egg
of?
Egg mixture is just basically pure egg yolks. Very little water, so the veal, when you
adhere,
it stays in it. You coat it really good.
What do you have, parsley in there also?
Parsley, chopped fresh parsley. It gives it the color.
Is there any reason we don't use the egg whites? Would you explain?
Egg white, we need to have egg yolks, which is, it coats the veal.
Coats the veal
otherwise
better.
You lose all the flour.
Would you suggest that for someone who's just making any kind of coating for their beef too?
Yes, if you like. You can, egg yolks, a lot of people are saying it's very rich in cholesterol, but,
right.
For this kind of a meal.
A little moderation,
yeah,
a little in moderation.
This kind of a meal you want.
Yes.
Otherwise, you lose all the bread in.
And then it's a quick saute?
Yes, very quick.
Okay.
Okay. The oil is really hot.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
How many seconds or minutes do you?
I'd say about a minute on each side.
A minute on each
minute
side?
Then we're going to finish it in a French sauce, which is right back there. It's made with the fresh chicken stock and herbs. In here.
Is it in here? Okay.
Yeah, it's all stocked. And from there, we reduce this. We make a Francaise sauce, which is made with the lemon butter, white wine.
Lemon butter and white wine for the Francaise sauce.
Okay.
Any special kind of wine?
Just a simple Chardonnay.
Simple Chardonnay.
Okay.
Good. Okay, now you're ready to flip
the
yes.
Get it done. Just we make it nice and golden brown. Then what we do, we dispose of the olive oil.
Oh, okay.
Yes. You take it away, otherwise it gets too rich, basically.
Oh, that's okay. A good idea. So you
then
remove to another
done.
Pan.
Okay.
Yes. That's a very good tip for us cooking
yes.
at home.
And we deglaze it with the Francaise sauce.
Right. Oh, that looks wonderful.
Yep.
The smell is just out of this world.
Okay.
I see you have some grilled vegetables here,
yes,
too.
Yes, that goes with it. We grilled some fresh vegetables with squash, zucchini, green beans,
and carrots.
Some baby carrots.
Right. And then you season the veal after you've...
It's all done.
It's all done.
Seasoning, it's all in the Francaise sauce.
Okay.
Sometimes if you want to make it a little bit smooth, you can just throw a little bit of sweet butter to make it smooth. But since it's rich enough, that's it.
That's perfect.
Yep.
And this is
so
veal Francaise.
Veal Francaise.
French style.
You can do this with a chicken Francaise too. It comes out.
Use
really
the same
good.
Ingredients except
yes.
change the meat.
The only
to
thing
poultry.
When you do this, you have to be very quick. Don't overcook it. Especially
right.
with veal. It gets. The more cook it, the more the...
Well, you pound it real thin
yes.
also. So if we're okay. doing cutlets, we'll pound them thin.
You have to pound them really
okay.
thin.
That's wonderful. Okay. Oh, Chef Julian, you are really great. Thank
okay.
you. Yes. And this is our finished dish. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Two.
As I usually do, I have my strainer and I strain the sauce.
So everybody gets little lumps, right?
Right?
Oh, that's beautiful. You strain it out. And serve it with the vegetables.
Roasted, grilled vegetables.
And this is an authentic French dish, veal Francaise.
Nice.
And the grilled vegetables.
Yeah, baby carrots.
Baby carrots.
Fresh.
I know the
beans.
French like the baby carrots and the baby
okay.
potatoes.
Yeah.
The little small potatoes. And is this the zucchini?
They're yellow squash.
Yellow
and zucchini.
Squash
they
and zucchini.
Nice and sweet. And
so you have a nice combination
potatoes,
of flavors.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Excellent.
Okay, then we garnish it with the cheese puff.
And what do we have for dessert?
For dessert, we have a cream puffs. We garnish it with a puff pastry, cheese puff pastry.
Excellent.
Just, just like this, sort of similar to a cracker.
That's beautiful. This is our finished dish, veal Francaise, garnished with the grilled vegetables, potatoes, green beans, yellow squash, zucchini, and this is your little cheese puffs for garnish. And along with our French dish, we have homemade cream puffs with whipped cream and fresh strawberries. And this is an authentic French dinner.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julian, for being our guest.
Thank
you.
It's a pleasure.
I'm Kim Vandegrift, and I'm a yellow jacket hunter. And what I do is basically people will call us, our name's gotten around the county, and I say our because I do have a partner that works with me from time to time. And we respond to calls about yellow jacket nests, and of course they can be very dangerous. I looked up on several internet sites that they kill from 50 to 150 people in this country every year. And we collect them because the lab uses them for antivenom, and they pay us by the pound for them. But we've had to do that, we've had to learn to be very careful doing that. And here, basically how I set it up is just like this. When I get a call, I'll make sure that if it's on somebody else's property, I get their permission. We'll go out and we'll take a look at the nest and see how to set up around it, because every nest is different. They're different sizes. They can be 2,000 bugs up to about 125,000 bugs is the biggest one we've collected. And that really is a difference in how you approach it. A small nest, we can go in pretty quickly. A big nest, we have to go in very carefully, obviously, to avoid injury. We go out and I take a lot of water with me. I'll start drinking water and Gatorade before I leave the house. I take two bee suits out with me. I've got a generator, small 1 kilowatt generator. I've got two telescoping PVC poles and two vacuum systems. One is a backup in case I need it. I have four fabricated traps. They're made out of plexiglass and they look like large cubes. Basically, I need to see those bugs coming into the trap as I'm vacuuming them from the nest. And the wand, the 20-foot wand, lets me position myself about 15 to 20 feet away from the nest. I usually like cover because once you tap on the nest with that wand, they're going to start coming out there big time, and they'll follow the wand, but if I'm behind another tree or structure, then they won't see me, and they'll be able to, I'll be able to avoid them. In my experience, yellow jackets are probably the meanest little bug I've ever encountered. They will pursue their victims for up to 1,000 yards. They can fly at 22 miles an hour. And again, they spit that chemical on their victims to track that victim so that other yellow jackets can find them quickly and continue to sting them. I've seen them attack animals and just swarm them and kill a squirrel within a matter of a few minutes. Because they're omnivorous, meaning they will eat both nectar, flour, sugar, and fruit, and meat, and insects, they are pretty much will eat anything that they can kill. So basically, they're not something to be taken lightly. Because they live in the ground, 90% of the nests that we take out are in the ground. The reason we do this is because there are about 2 to 4 million people in this country that are deathly allergic to wasp stings. And the antivenom, which is made from the yellow jacket's venom, is used to treat people who have entered to the emergency room and hospitals, trauma centers, to save their lives. Somebody will call me and simply say, hey, I got a yellow jacket nest, can you come take a look at it? And we'll go out and take a look at the nest and determine by the size of the nest and the number of yellow jackets coming in and out, just what it's going to take to harvest that nest. Of course, the location is important too. If the nest is remote inside a vacant lot, for example, where we have to walk equipment in, it's going to be a lot more difficult. If it's up next to a person's house where it's easily accessible from the road, then obviously we can do that a lot more quickly. The size of the nest is very important. A small nest of 2,000 or 3,000 yellow jackets is not a big problem, but you get a big nest that has over 100,000 in it, and they can be deadly. I prepare for going out and doing this by starting out drinking a lot of water and a lot of Gatorade, because I have to put on 3 layers of clothing. I start with a layer just like this, usually blue jeans and a long sleeve t-shirt. Then I'll put a bee suit on over that. Then I'll put another bee suit on over that. And the last one is hooded, fully hooded with zippers. And we of course put cotton balls in where the zippers come together. We put duct tape over that, because my experience, they'll find a way in if they can. They get on your suit. And generally we can do that rather safely at that point if we don't aggravate them too much and get them too excited. Now, yellow jackets, when they get excited and aggravated, they'll come out 100, 150 feet from the nest in a big cloud. They'll light on anything and everything and start stinging and spitting on it. Now, they spit a chemical. It's a tracker chemical. And when they do that, I can smell it. It has a unique kind of a musky, sweet odor to it. And when they spit on me, I'm being tagged. And that means I need to move. I need to get out of that area. Otherwise, I'll attract 10 or 15 more, which will spit on me and try to sting me at the same time. Now, when we go to a nest and we set up on the nest, we will put our equipment out. We'll put the generator out to run the vacuum system. We'll put the traps in line. We'll both suit up. We'll look at each other to make sure that our suits are tight, airtight, so they're not going to let any bugs into them. And understand that when it's like it is right now, about 95 degrees outside, sitting in a bee suit for half an hour, you're at about 135 degrees. I can only gather about 2 pounds, which is about 6,600 of them at a time, because if you get too big a mass, it's like freezing a turkey. If you try to freeze the bigger the meat you're trying to freeze, the longer it takes to freeze in the middle. And if that venom is not frozen within about 30 minutes, it spoils, and of course the laboratory will not then accept the order. They have to have 85% good rate on their venom that they get from us. So what we do is we capture them in 1 to 2 pound increments. We put them under dry ice, which chills them down immediately. As soon as I get back to the house, I'll open the cooler, I'll put on surgical gloves, and we dig into the traps. We get them out quickly, we put them into Ziploc bags, and then of course we label those bags with the time, the date, and the location of the nest that we're taking from. And we put those inside another layer in larger Ziploc bags, and we place those into a chest freezer. And then when I get a call from the lab, or I'll get a letter from them requesting 8 or 10 pounds, I will package that up in 2-inch thick styrofoam containers with 40 pounds of dry ice around the small cardboard container containing the packaged and frozen yellow jackets. And then we'll ship that overnight, FedEx, to the laboratory. Now, people have asked me, are those bugs still alive? By the time we freeze them in that chest freezer, no. But they are still alive by the time I get them home. And if I let a couple of them thaw out while I'm processing them, they will come back to life and fly off. One of the things I want to share with you is this is not a business for the faint of heart. Obviously, if you'd mind getting stung, even just occasionally, I would not try this out of your own home, especially with something as dangerous as yellow jackets. And you may be wondering, well, why does he do this business? Well, I think I have to be a little bit crazy, but I do call my wife every time before I leave and let her know where I am and how long I plan on being there and when I'm coming back. But it's not definitely a business for everybody. Only if you are the kind of person that enjoys being out in the woods and has a high tolerance for pain, obviously. And I really do enjoy being a public service and saving people's lives. That's important to me.